Good morning. Nice to have you all here today. A few different little things are happening this morning. My wife, Gwen, is away. She's off on a trip with my daughter, visit some family. I could have gone if I was asked, but okay. I'm not bitter. No, I think, have some alone time is neat. It is. Because of that, of course, Gwen won't be singing. Stan does a bit more solo when this thing happens. So we haven't fired her. She will return. She's just not here currently. Monday is city prayer, 1 o'clock, out of town park. Weather's still good?
Yeah.
So we'll do that on Monday. I'd like to thank everyone who came and helped me try to construct that shed. We're not quite done yet, but it was a work. The instructions aren't quite as clear as I would like them to be. And we've built quite a few things around here. Some are better than others. This one, I give credit to it that everything seemed to be spelled correctly. Some of them don't even do that. But there was a few pieces. I think there should have been a little bit more information. A few more arrows, a few more things. You live, you learn. You just have to tear it all apart and do it over again. Anyway, but I think there's a life lesson there, maybe. Maybe there's a life lesson there. Do it all over again. Anything else that needs to be mentioned of great importance? Let's sing songs to the Lord.
Good morning.
And stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I am never alone. You're a good, good father. To you are, to you are, to you are, and I'm loved by you. To I am, to I am, to I am. Oh, I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know that we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we can say a word. You're a good, good father. To you are, to you are, to you are, and I'm loved by you. To I am. To I am, to I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. Perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us. You are perfect in all of your ways. Perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us. Oh, it's love so undeniable. I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable. I can hardly think as you call me deeper still, as you call me deeper still, as you call me deeper still into love, love, love. You're a good, good father. To you are, to you are, to you are. By you. Father, to you are, to you are, to you are, and I'm loved by you, to I am, to I am, to I am.
Please have a seat.
Good morning. It's always a pleasure to stand up here and look out at the congregation because I sit up close to the front and I never know who's behind me. And this morning, I meant to mention it early, but every once in a while we'll have somebody visit who used to come to church here a long, long time ago. It felt like a long, long time ago to me. And Debbie Brown is here this morning. She, raise your hand. If you remember Debbie, if you were here when she was coming, please say good morning to her. Right now? Right now, just bow your heads with me and let's just welcome Jesus into this place. What a father you are. What a father you are, Jesus. You're a good, good father. That's who you are, and we thank you for that. We come together this morning, Lord, to praise you, to have a moment of solitude with you, to leave the world behind for a while within these walls. And I thank you for that opportunity. I pray that you'll be with all of those participating this morning. Be with Gwen and her daughter as they visit family. Be with us as we worship you. Lord, let this be a good, good day where our spirit is a light with your spirit. We ask this in your name. Amen.
If you're able, please stand.
Blessed be your name, the land that is plentiful, your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name, I'm found in the desert place, I'll walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name, the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name, road marked with suffering, those pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in lone, still I'm gonna say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Someone they love long before it was their time. Feel like the days you had were not enough when you said goodbye. And to all other people with burdens and pains keeping you back from your life, you believe that there's nothing and there is no one who can make it right. There is hope for the helpless, rest for the weary, love for the broken heart. There is grace and forgiveness, mercy and healing, meet you wherever you are. Cry out to Jesus. Cry to Jesus. For the marriage that's struggling just to hang on, lost all of their faith and love, and they've done all they can to make it right again, still it's not enough. For the ones who can't break the addictions and chains, try to give up but you come back again. Just remember that you're not alone in your shame and your suffering. There is hope for the helpless, rest for the weary, love for the broken heart. There is grace and forgiveness, mercy and healing, meet you wherever you are. Cry out to Jesus. When you're lonely and it feels like the whole world is falling on you, you just reach out, you just cry out to Jesus. Cry to Jesus. To the widow who struggles with being alone, wiping the tears from her eyes. For the children around the world without a home, say a prayer tonight. There is hope for the helpless, rest for the weary, love for the broken heart. There is grace and forgiveness, mercy and healing, meet you wherever you are. There is hope for the helpless, rest for the weary, love for the broken heart.
For those who've been along for the ride and watched from home and have been present, we've been going through a series on some Christian basics. Last week we talked about the Bible, you know, and how it's been translated over years and how many copies there are of it. We talked about soteriology, the doctrine of being saved, the study of being, what does it take to be saved? We talked about Christology, and we looked at all the different verses where Jesus talks about himself. What other place to learn about Jesus than straight from the source and what he says about himself? Well, today I take a slight detour. This is still, but it's just been on my mind a great deal. And I want to talk about denominations. Denominations. You know, many years ago, I was delivering some restaurants, and because I delivered restaurants for so long, I would often see the same waiter or cook here, and a couple years later, he worked over there, and I did it for over 20-something years. So, I mean, 10 years later, he was working over there. I mean, you know him. Hey, Mike, how's it going? Hey, Joe, you know, whatever. Well, one time I walked into a particular restaurant, knew the guy. I said something, he said something else, I said something. Oh, yeah, a guy from church does that, whatever he was talking about. He goes, church? Oh, yeah, you live in Fernley, he says. He says, my mother lives in Fernley. What church do you go to? I said, well, I go to Fernley Free Methodist Church. He goes, oh, she would never go to a denominational church. That was actually the reply. Now, I don't know her extent of the mother's, all of her beliefs. I do know the kid knew what they were. Somehow the word denomination instantly was undesirable at best and maybe evil. Even evil or, you know, wrong. I was talking to an Assembly of God pastor one time. You know what he told me? We're really not a denomination. We're really not a denomination. Does everybody know what the largest Pentecostal denomination in the United States is? Assembly of God. Well, here, I want to look at it. There are more than 69 million Assembly of God members worldwide, making the Assembly of God world the largest Pentecostal denomination. That is straight from AG.com. I double-checked it as recently as this morning. Clearly, the woman in question, my first little story there, something's wrong with denominations. Talking to the pastor, didn't want to be associated with the word denominations. Within the last week, a pastor said to me, well, you're in a denomination, we're not. As if, again, there's something inherently evil about such a thing. I was at a wedding yesterday. Did not have to perform it. It was a neighbor getting married. Happy to be there. In fact, it was kind of neat, just living your life. I was at their parents' wedding, and it was just, it was just one of those mile markers in life. You know what I mean? Here I am at a wedding of the people I saw get married, all those. And just life, and it was a beautiful thing. It was a beautiful thing. But it just made me ponder life for a second and how much time's gone by. So I'm at this wedding, and I'm meeting and greeting some people. I'm trying to come out of my shell and be friendly. And so I was introduced to one person as, oh, this is Mike. He's a pastor in town, you know. And another person was saying, I was talking to him, said, well, praise the Lord, it's a good day, and thank God, you know. I said, oh, yeah, you attend church, do you? Oh, yeah, yeah. And these were some of the family visiting from the in-law side of the clan, out of state. And I said, what kind of church do you go to? You know, and he said, a Baptist church. I said, what kind? Right? Because there's more than one. Yeah. Oddly enough, there's more than some of the other big names, too. So I was talking to another guy there, and another guy had said, oh, that guy goes to church. So, I mean, I'm not looking for these people, but they're being pointed out to me, you know. So I walk over and say, howdy. I said, what kind of church you go to? Oh, I go to a non-denominational church. I said, oh, I'm the pastor of the Free Methodist Church here in town. Now, at this moment, I've only made one statement. I'm the pastor of the Free Methodist Church in town. This is not ramming denominationalism down his throat. I'm not even inviting him to church. He lives out of state, you know. To which he said, well, I don't really believe in denominations. I prefer a church gets together and really decides their own doctrine as a group. Most of these stories I'm telling you are just in the last week. As recently as a Friday afternoon, we're trying to clean up the mess from trying to get the shed going. We're trying to put some things out of sight. I don't want them to wander off in the night. And lo and behold, a gentleman rides up by the picnic tables on an older bicycle with a backpack and starts heading my way. And it was a quick thought. This guy's looking for cash. Why? Because that often happens when I'm out there working and someone approaches me. And as he approached me, he said, I was raised Methodist. What's the difference between a Methodist and a free Methodist? Which just goes to show you can't always judge a book by its cover. But I would put money that he still was some sort of transient, but he wasn't just after money. And he didn't say it like, oh, you're a denomination. He was honest and curious about it, you know? And so I explained what I could to him. He later wanted to explain he likes Buddhist ideas a lot too. So, I don't think we'll see him on Sunday anytime soon, but you never know. I have been surprised before. So, pastors in town have said things, guys at weddings. The one guy I talked to at the wedding, he was fairly knowledgeable. We talked to him for quite a while. I was happy to see the guy reads. He's not a pastor, as far as he didn't mention he's a pastor or anything like that. But he knew some stuff. I was happy. This guy's been reading. You know, he's looked at some websites or something. He had some information in his head. But at one point, he said something like, well, and I said, what kind of Baptist? And I think he technically said Southern Baptist. But then he added, denomination is not as important as loving God and others. I would agree. In fact, I would tell you to this day, I hope people realize you're a Christian and they understand that part long before they figure out what church you go to or what brand it is. In fact, when you get to heaven, don't say, hey, I was a free Methodist. Point at Jesus and say, I'm with that guy. Right? That's what you're shooting for. That's what you're shooting for. Well, I agree with that statement. Denomination not as important as loving God and others. But in the back of my mind, but which denomination are we talking about? Because not all are the same. Not all are the same. They may be similar or even have a similar name. You know how many churches use some form of Church of God or Church of Christ? Multiple. But so they can't all be the same because they're not all the same. They actually have different headquarters, different theories, different beliefs, but they use that. Some part of that, a Church of God in Christ is another one. You could get a both of them on that one, you know, the Church of God and the Church of Christ. And they're not all the same. So now, many denominations are very similar. In fact, to the untrained eye, they're almost identical. You walk in, you hear some announcements, a couple of songs, guy talks for a while about the Bible, the end. But you go in some other ones, maybe there's some robes, maybe there's some candles going on, you know. And there's a lot of those, and not all of those are the same. Presbyterians are one, Eastern Orthodox another, Catholic Church yet another, and they're not all the same. Well, it could become quite confusing. And oddly enough, there's two different views on this I generally run across. The first one is the church person. And either they have a favorite, well, I was an Episcopalian, I'll always be an Episcopalian, there's that one. And there's the other one who thinks it's evil. And there's really not too many in between, but they seem to already have their favorite camp or they think they're all evil. But that's church-going folk. Unchurch-going folk don't know what the difference between a Baptist and a Methodist is. And really, I can tell you from experience, based on what I've seen, it doesn't really matter. Why do I say this? Because I've seen people go from one church, which had a certain set of beliefs, to another one, which had 93% of the similar beliefs. There was some wild cards in there, which were different. Maybe not enough to leave. So that doctrine didn't mind changing. I've seen ministers go from one denomination to another. I think of a guy who went from Free Methodist to like Presbyterianism or something. That's a big jump, depending on the type of Presbyterian church it is, because there's more than one. They're the same and they're different. That will be a reoccurring theme today. For instance, at a car show, someone may walk up to me and say, is that a Le Mans? Well, after wanting to slap them upside the head, it's a GTO. To the untrained eye, they're almost identical. They are. I even had some people say, is that a Chevelle? Well, technically, again, they deserve a something. But GM used the same platform. They're roughly the same shape. They were made at the same years. You know, so to think it's a Chevelle really isn't that much of a jump for the untrained, you know, amateur car enthusiast. Right? Churches are that way. They're very similar. For instance, what's the difference between a Quick Stop and a 7-Eleven? Yeah. I mean, well, they both got gas. They're in the same town. They're not too far from each other. You know, I particularly like the idea of a slushy once in a while, or a slurpee, or icy, or whatever the particular building calls it. However, I do prefer the cherry flavor at Quick Stop better than 7-Eleven. Throwing that out there. I do. Now, you could say they're the same. Oh, indeed, they are in many, many ways. And they're slightly different. Owned by different people, operated, different corporations, different things. Well, now we throw in the independent market on the corner. Again, similar. But it's not a chain. So in a sense, if you were traveling, you walked into an independent store, what's going to be in there? Ain't no telling. Well, if you walked into a 7-Eleven across the states, you have a good idea it might be something similar to what you're used to. You'll find a Slurpee machine somewhere on the wall. It may be a different wall, but you will find a Slurpee machine on a wall somewhere. So very same, very different, depending on what you're looking at. So right now, just in saying that, I've explained many denominations. Many denominations. However, if you tell me you're super hungry and you need something to eat, but you don't want to drive all the way to Walmart, if I said, well, just go to Big R and get something to eat. It's a store, and it's down the road a piece, you know. And technically, there's food inside the building. What kind of food is it? Yeah, pig chow, puppy chow, goat chow, whatever, you know. Do little doggy chows actually eat chow? How's that work? Chow, chow? Is it made of chows? These are questions I ask myself at night. You're right. It is a store. It is local. There is food inside. But, of course, what kind of food? This also explains denominations. It looks similar. It sounds similar. But it is a completely different meal. If you tell me I go to such and such community church, what do they believe? Well, ain't no telling. They could follow the Bible. They could believe in Christ. They could believe in a metaphorical Christ right up alongside of a metaphorical Buddha and a metaphorical, you know, Krishna, and just throw them all together. They're a community church. There's churches like that. They could be incredibly conservative, so they squeak when they walk. They're so tight. Or they could be incredibly liberal where anything goes, and much of the Bible is irrelevant based on their actions. This also is out there. So just because it has a name doesn't mean a whole lot. No, just because it doesn't have a name. To kind of sum it up, well, what does the word denomination mean? Well, from the Oxford Dictionary, a recognized autonomous branch of a Christian church. The Presbyterian community is the second largest denomination in the country, is a phrase they quote. Similarly, religious group is another word for denomination. Sect, church, cult, movement, faith community, a body, a persuasion, a religious persuasion, a communion, an order, a fraternity, a brotherhood, a sisterhood, a school, a faith, a creed, a belief, a religious belief, belief in religion, and a sodality. Which means something Catholic-y, I think. I really do. I think it's a word associated when you're talking about certain Catholic groups, monks and nuns and things. I think that's what the word's from. But don't quote me. And you know what? Why not have fun and look some of these things up when you get home? You know, have fun with it. Well, it also mentions the face value of a banknote, a coin, a postage stamp is a denomination. $100 or so in small denominations. Similar words include value, unit, grade, and size. From the Webster Dictionary, the act of denominating, picking things, making groups, figuring these things out. The denomination of U.S. dollars, the value, size, or various size of metric dimensions, especially the value of a particular coin or bill, especially a general name for a category listed under the general denominations of gifts. 4, a religious organization whose congregations are united in their adherence to its beliefs and practices. People from several different Christian denominations is the phrase they use. So is a denomination a good thing or a bad thing? Well, it depends on the denomination. In fact, I would argue there's both good and bad. I would argue it's a double-edged sword. I think many things are double-edged swords. She's not here. I think being married can be a double-edged sword, right? Right? By what do I mean by that? There's good and there's bad. With her being gone, I realize I miss a lot of the good this weekend. I do. A double-edged sword. When I was a Teamster, there were certain rules in play that the company agreed to on a legally binding contract, and so did the body of workers, the bargaining unit. Well, is that good or bad? Well, it depends on which way you look at it. Generally, we got a little higher wage than the average person doing the same job, so that was certainly good because we had this bargaining unit. However, another good thing was because seniority was the key for advancement and things like that, the boss couldn't hire his nephew and just give him your job and send you home. Or give him the preferred job in the warehouse or whatever and make you go work the trash, right? Because seniority, guy's brand new, he can go work the trash. That's a good thing. It stops nepotism, for instance, and favoritism and whoever golfs with their boss type of things, right? That's great. However, what if you're really good and a position opens and the guy above you isn't? He's going to get that position. He may not be trying very hard, old, tired, dim-witted, whatever you want to call the guy. I've had coworkers that qualify for all of these, sometimes at once. Right? I am. And yet, that's a bad thing. That the best person for the job may not get the job. Now, of course, I realize everyone thinks they are the best person for the job. But I've even seen it where I'm positive that guy was best for the job, and they took that guy. I've seen it. I see people nodding their heads. They know what I'm talking about. This isn't rocket surgery. This isn't hard to understand. So, independent versus corporate is really what we're talking about here. Because this evil connotation of the word denomination isn't in the dictionary, it's in people's heads. And I don't even know how they even define it. What do they think happens when the word denomination is applied? Well, I know some people think there must be a tyrannical top-down rules enforced upon the people. I would suggest that there are denominations more like that. In fact, there's some denominations, they say they agree to this code. They all have their names, and they get together once a year to have a conference. It's not really a top-down thing, but it's a more of a communal agreement. It's not a thing. which is better, to be independent or corporate? Again, guess what the answer is going to be? Both. Why? Depending on the time and place, depending on the application. Should you be a local, you may know that the independent restaurant on the corner is the best place in town, like grandma's cooking. However, if you're traveling and you got your option between even a McDonald's or a Denny's, something you're familiar with, or Joe's Shack, It's a little better now with Googles and reviews and things, but you just don't walk into Joe's Shack necessarily because you don't know what you're going to get. While at something you're familiar with, you do know what you're going to get, generally speaking. So which is better? Well, it depends on your application. Which is better from the purpose of the business itself? Well, an independent restaurant is independent. Right? You run out of flour, you can't always go across the street to the other restaurant and borrow a bag. Sometimes, if you're friendly enough, but not. I noticed when I used to deliver all the porter subs in Reno, if one ran out of something, they just went and got it from another store and borrowed it, back and forth. Now, how is that? As opposed to, what if there's snow on the hill? What if trucks aren't coming over the pass? that those chains can still keep going to some degree, and an independent restaurant is out of their favorite bread or sauce or whatever they're known for. So in that case, the corporate structure is more beneficial. However, in an independent situation, you can make decisions much quicker. I'm going to go to the store and get some flour. Yep, off you go. In a corporate setting, well, what flour is it? Does it meet our standards? Does it meet our specs? You know, how much are you paying for? Did you go to the right? I mean, or you can't use that. We're contracted to a flour company over here, and you have to use our flour whenever it shows up. And I'm using it as an example. I'm not saying that flour is that hard to deal with, but so there's both. There can be all the extra rules, and there can be no rules. Well, I find both of those to be too many rules I don't like and no rules. It's nice. Have you ever got together to work with a bunch of people and no one knows what's going on? The boss called everyone in the back room and then you're just standing there, you know? Unless someone tells you what to do, you don't know if you're supposed to clean, sweep, move a box, take a break, which is what's going to happen if no one shows up. Right? You don't know what to do. So it's good to have some rules, some structure, some guidance. At the same token, someone standing over your shoulder every, you know, that's no fun whatsoever. Well, let's suppose you have an independent restaurant, and it's doing pretty well. You'd like to start up another one. Is that wrong? Is that evil? But once you do, do you expect the management from one to zigzag back and forth between the two nonstop, or do you find more management? And in doing so, do you create a regional manager if you get enough of them collected? And the answer is yes, and it makes perfect sense. Why would it make different sense if a church was involved? But again, not all churches are the same. Not all denominations. For further study, if you're really interested in this, there's a YouTube channel like called Ready to Harvest. Ready to Harvest. All this guy does is talk about denominations. He puts up two-minute videos if you want the quick fix. He puts up longer videos to really explain things in detail. I looked at him when I first saw him. I thought he was horribly young and didn't know if he could even drive or shave. Turns out he's a professor at a Baptist seminary. I don't really hear him doing a lot of bias in it. He just sums up the facts. According to their website, these guys believe this. And he really puts it on a chart so you can see. He does different denominations, what contrasts are and their benefits. He does those denominations with the same name but sub-different. Methodist, Free Methodist. I remember my wife's uncle is a Congregational Methodist. E.M. Bounds, the famous, prolific, voluminous writer of prayer, was a Southern Methodist. That's a lot of Methodists. And technically, Wesleyan churches and Nazarene churches also are out of the Methodist tradition. When I first came to this church, the pastor had been a Nazarene before he got here. He was just that similar. They have a different form of government, maybe some different little details here and there. And we're talking about corporations. Well, if you have two district directors and one regional director over the state, or maybe you have one of each and two on top, or does it really matter? You know, you do what you want to do, and churches do that. So you'll see a difference in structures of the chain of command. Some of them very loose. In a denominational church, you have a chance that, let's suppose the pastor goes a little crazy and starts teaching things that most everyone's like, I've never read that. You know, where are we going with this? Well, you have an option. You have options. You can actually call up the ladder. See, get some help. Figure out what's going on. Is this right? You can ask that. What if it's an independent church? You don't like it, get out. I'm the pastor. Have a nice day. There is no great recourse, generally. And I saw this, what can happen sometimes, it happens in any church, not just denominations or corporate or independent. And that is, I saw this cartoon one time. It showed the pastor, he had this goofy cone head. And you know how some churches have the pastor throne chair, then they have the deacon chairs? You guys ever seen that? Well, all the deacon chairs, they all had big cone heads. And the guy's talking and says, I see the pastor handpicks his own men. Again, the similar mindset, similar. And of course, that's great for when you want to agree, but you don't get any opinions. You know, everyone says, yeah, sounds great, pastor, you go. You need other opinions. Someone should say, well, wait a minute, what about this? Now, while that takes a while, it actually is balance. So, ready to harvest, should you want to look at, I said, he's got some two-minute videos, and he compares four methods, he compares, you know how many types of Lutherans there are? Wisconsin Synod, Missouri Synod, there's a congregational one, which is, some of them were Norwegian people from the Netherlands and over that way, Norway, came to the Americas. Well, they're Lutherans, but they wanted a church in their own language, in their traditions, and there's enough of them. Now you have a Lutheran branch which has a Norwegian background. And the Germans immigrants got together. Now you have one that's the, is that the Missouri Synod or the Wisconsin Synod? Missouri Synod, I think. Don't quote me. Watch the videos. Comes from that thing. Well, and you got all these different kinds. So when you say denominations, you are painting with a brush that is not even going to cover all the, you know, you're trying to put them all into one group and it just ain't going to happen. Not going to happen. Some have hierarchies, some don't, minimal hierarchies. Some believe almost the same thing and are different, and some are the difference between getting something to eat at Arby's and getting something to eat at Big R. And so it's not that easy to say these things. The Bible. Colossians chapter 4, verse 16. The Apostle Paul's closing out his letter to and he says this, after this letter has been read to you, see to it that it is also read in the church of the Laodiceans, and that you in turn read the letter from the Laodiceans. What's he encouraging? He wants them to be on the same page. He wants them to have similar doctrine, similar ideas, understand Christianity in a similar way. Well, that is what denominations do. Now, he's working at a time when it was kind of one church per town. Christianity was just getting started. And when I read this, I do have to mention, most of you who are Bible scholars realize that there is no letter from the church of Laodicea. Clearly, he's telling them to read it, but it's not included in the Bible. We don't have it. There's a couple of theories. One, that it just wasn't copied enough and spread around enough that it just didn't survive time. And there's another thought that actually the letter we call the Epistle to the Ephesians is actually originally from the Laodicean church. Doesn't bother me. You know why? Because the Apostle Paul says the same things in most of his letters. So whether I have one extra church to compare it to or one less, I can still see there's a very common theme and thread to most everything he teaches, and there's no wild card. So one more letter would probably be right along the same design. I'm not too worried about that. But there is this reference to this. And of course, from this, those people who like the conspiracy theories, you know, what was in there? You know, well, maybe there was stuff like thou shalt sin, and maybe they left it out for that reason. You know, you laugh, but people have these crazy ideas. And they do it with all sorts of old texts. Bonus point, and just for those who like to know, there is what was called in early England the Sinner's Bible. The Sinner's Bible. There was a printing error. And in many, many copies, it said, thou shalt commit adultery. You leave off a T, it just changes everything, doesn't it? You just leave off that T, it just changes everything. So, again, he wants them to have similar information and be connected in Christ. Of course, in Christ. 1 Timothy chapter 1. This is Paul, and we've talked about this before. Most of the letters he writes to churches, but 1 and 2 Timothy and Titus, he writes to the leader, the pastor, the elder, whatever you want to call him. And you see his instructions from their side. He's telling them what to do, not what the church necessarily has to do. He's telling them what to say, what to do. So they're pastoral epistles, 1 and 2 Timothy and Titus. 1 Timothy, he explains why he sent them there. 1 Timothy, verse 3. As I urged you when I went to Macedonia, stay there in Ephesus so that you may command certain people not to teach false doctrine any longer, or devote themselves to myths and endless genealogies. Such things promote controversial speculation rather than advancing God's work, which is by faith. His purpose for being there, Timothy's purpose for being there, according to what we just read, was to command certain people not to teach false doctrine any longer. He had some sort of authority to do such things. And if it was just everybody come up with their own doctrine as they want to, and just you find your peace and you find your peace, he wouldn't be sending them. He actually expects us to be on the same page on many of these issues. And there are some things to me that just don't matter. For instance, the time the church starts. For some people, that's a biggie. You know, that's a, but for me, one church starts at 10, one church starts at 9:30, one goes 9:45 to 10, whatever. I don't see that as being a big issue, but there are differences. Some of the differences are negligible. There's really not even to be, you know, well, we stand when we sing that song and you sit when you sing that song. Okay, you know, if that's a deal breaker for you or vice versa. To me, stand if you can stand, and if you get tired, sit down. I think both work. I always come back to that both, don't I? He tells them what they're doing wrong. They're devoting themselves to myths and endless genealogies. Is there anything wrong with knowing your family tree? Well, depends on what you do with it. I was happy to do my DNA and found out what nationality was. I was adopted. I had no clue. You know, it was kind of nice to find out after 55 years or whatever it was. Oh, I'm English. Who knew? You know? So again, now I know some people, you know, my great great third cousin was General Grant, you know, or something like that, you know, or uncle, grandfather twice removed. And I'm like, that's nice, I guess. Does it really mean anything? I mean, are you going to get a free soda at 7-Eleven because he's, you know, the general's your uncle? No, it's really not going to do much for you. It just sounds cool. You know, Cary Grant was my third cousin's barber's nephew, or something. You know, okay, whatever. I'm making some of the, but you know what I'm talking about. You know what I'm talking about. They devote themselves to promote controversy, speculation, rather than God's work, which is by faith. And there's many people who would still, they forgot everything I've said since I mentioned Laodicea. They're still working on the controversies of Laodicea. You know, there are people who would do that. But after I mentioned that, their wheels are running. It means this, or it could mean that, or, oh, you know, let's dig into this. I might find out the earth is flat, or they never landed on the moon, or all sorts of things. There's web pages out there for it. Whatever you want to believe, you can find a web page for it. Look at verse 5. The goal of this command is love, which comes from a pure heart, a good conscience, and sincere faith. I can talk to people from many other churches and denominations. Right? Part of it is because I understand where they're coming from. I've researched their theories and their thoughts. I know that we agree on major points. And if there's some details, you know, you have a GTO, you have a Chevelle, you know, you guys can argue it out, but the rest of us, two old cars. Look what it says in verse 6. Some have departed from these and have turned to meaningless talk. Verse 7. They want to be teachers of the law, but they do not know what they are talking about or what they so confidently affirm. They want to be teachers of the law. They think they have it figured out. And he's saying they don't even know what they're talking about. Could such a crazy thing happen today? Oh, indeed. You bet. A lot of people have all sorts of crazy. They tell me. I don't even ask them. Oh, you're a pastor of a church? Well, I'm 1 Corinthians 3, I really think that the church of Laodicea, you know, they'll tell me these things. They're out there. They believe in them. They're teaching these things. It goes on and on and on. While we're in the book of 1 Timothy, he talks about electing leaders in 1 Timothy chapter 3. And in it, in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1, he says, here is a trustworthy saying. Whoever aspires to be an overseer desires a noble task. Right? Somebody wants to be in charge, they want to be an overseer, they desire a noble task. And it goes on. Now, the overseer is to be above reproach, honest, sincere, hospitable, you know, all these, because you want a righteous guy. You don't want him to be sinner average, like the, you know, just the average Joe. He comes to church once in a while. You don't want that for your leader. It's supposed to be a righteous guy. But the point I'd like to make from reading this is there is such a thing as an overseer. And you know what that word is traditionally in the King James? Bishop. And traditionally, a bishop is in charge of churches in one area, or over churches, multiple areas. So you have like your conference superintendent or your manager, but then you may a regional manager, but then you have a full-blown, you know, district manager, something higher up, you know. Well, that's kind of what a bishop is, higher up the chain. Here it is, overseer. It also says in it also mentions deacons in that passage, and they're supposed to have the same qualifications. So now there's deacons, and there's an overseer, So all these are being mentioned. So there's those parts of the body. And for those who like to just have a list, okay, every church must have 2.3 deacons per 100 people and a pastor. And then maybe the pastor should have someone he answers to. Some people think the board's a good idea, right? But the board's not necessarily full of theologians, right? But average Joes. So what if you start getting crazy theology? How would you even know? Well, depending on your own biblical studies and understanding, it just, and then what would you do with the pastor, back to the point, what would you do with the pastor, how do you go over their head? So here, the deacons have someone over them. We've seen that areas have someone over them in the case of Timothy. He's going to, he's in Ephesus. Watch this one in Titus. Titus 1, verse 5. The reason I left you in Crete is that you might put in order that which was left unfinished and appoint an elder in every town as I directed you. His job is over how many towns? Well, it depends on how many towns were in Crete at that time. But my guess is every cove that could handle a fishing village probably had a fishing village. I don't know about minotaurs and mazes, but, you know, this is Crete. He's telling them, that's your job, is to appoint elders in all these places. He is above the average church person. I'm not saying the church isn't necessarily evil if they don't have someone above them, but I'm certainly not saying it's evil because it's biblical. In fact, I often think it's funny that many a person I know who are big King James fans go to churches that have no bishops. Isn't that kind of funny? You know, it says right here you have to have a bishop, you know. Well, we have a pastor. Well, okay, it didn't say pastor, but okay. And for those who really want just a perfect list, it's not in the Bible. We can look at a lot of verses and get a good idea. There's supposed to be hierarchy, but exactly how many, what name you want to call them, and what exactly are all the details of the positions. I can tell you in a small church, I don't care what your position is, you wear many hats, you know. The floor's got a mess on it. Well, you're a janitor right now. You know, it's just that simple. You don't get to call the janitor. You are the janitor. And this goes on in many things. And many of us have different parts. In fact, I'm in charge of three things besides being the pastor. I'm in charge of the evangelism budget and the maintenance budget because I do a lot of the maintenance and the missionary budget stuff I oversee. And I think Gwen has two or three jobs. She's a church secretary while simultaneously the treasurer and the singer. And sometimes I make her help me. You know, so she might actually be sewing something or cleaning something or whatever else. And this goes on for all the different people who volunteer. Speaking of volunteers, a few of you weren't here a little bit ago when I thanked everybody for helping me out yesterday and spending some time to get the shed built. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I couldn't ask for much more support. However, there are two awnings outside that need to be installed. Just throwing that out there in case you're bored. And it goes on in Titus, the same thing. An elder must be blameless. And he gives a similar list of rules and codes. What an elder. Remember, he's using the word elder now. He's not using the word bishop, and he's not using the word deacon. Bishop is episkopos in the Greek. Deacon is the word diakonos. And elders is presbyteros. Well, you can see presbyteros is where Presbyterians, elders, get their name from. Episcopos, Episcopal Church, you know, that's where they call it, the bishop run kind of thing. Verse 6, an elder must be blameless. Now, are these the only people that can manage a church? It hasn't even mentioned pastor yet, right? So far we got bishop or overseer, we got deacon, we got elder. But wait, there's more. Ephesians chapter 1, do I have a chapter? Is that chapter 11? Do you have chapter 11? Yeah. I only have a 1 on here. I hope you didn't get the 1. I need 11. So Christ himself gave. Christ himself gave. What? Apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. These are also people who help make the church happen. These are also positions mentioned that Christ appoints. They are gifted by Christ. They are sent by Christ. Apostles, well, we read about them. Prophets, there's certainly quite a few of those in the Bible, both Old and New Testament. Evangelists, generally speaking, the word from evangelion, the word for gospel, for good news, would be a person who's concerned with the gospel. In today's language, it generally means someone who goes out preaching, you need to get right with Jesus, which I agree with. However, I'm not sure what all the different departments there were. Maybe it changed per church, and sometimes if there was a mess, the evangelist had to clean it up too. I don't know. But there's evangelists, and then finally, pastors and teachers are mentioned. Pastors mean shepherd, and teachers, of course, is from teaching for teachers. And there are some people who say in the Greek, maybe that's one word, a pastor teacher. It's actually one position and not two. Well, everybody teaches. You know, some do it with words, some open up books and charts, and other people just live their lives teaching good or bad on the way they do it. So everyone's a teacher in some sense. And then why do we have all these positions? Look at verse 12. To equip his people for work of service so that the body of Christ may be built up. What is the ultimate purpose of these? To build up the people in the church, to build up the body of Christ, to help them, what does it mean, build up? To mature, to grow in faith, to grow in knowledge, to grow in love. These are the things a church should be doing. I don't care what name is on the outside, if you're following the Bible whatsoever. Why do you do this? What is the goal? Look at verse 13. Until we all reach unity in faith and the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. To grow together, to understand who God is, to again mature. And I tell people this because some people, I go to church, I got saved, and they don't realize there's more you can do. Grow is one of them. You can learn more. You can understand more. And it's not always easy lessons, but you can get some life lessons to teach you that maybe I shouldn't have judged there. Maybe I should have been more kind. Maybe I should forgive because I've been hating that guy for quite some time and he's still alive. You know, my hating him hasn't hurt him any. Who's it hurting? Me. So you learn these things as you go. You're growing, attaining the full measure and the fullness of Christ. Why does he want people in the church to help people do this? Verse 14. Then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning craftiness of people and the deceitful scheming. We won't be babies anymore. Well, now, you think of infants, I mean, they're fun to watch. I just watched Samuel come in and smile at his daddy and wave and just warms your little heart because teenagers don't do that, right? You know, you walk in the room just like, and go right back to whatever they're doing. I'm partly kidding. Beautiful infants. And what else we notice if you watch an infant long enough? They can be incredibly selfish. I don't want to go to bed. I don't want to brush my teeth. I want Cheerios for three meals. I mean, they're going to tell you these things. They're pretty sure they know what they know. And if you don't like it, I'll have a tantrum. I'll cry. Or I'll do this. I'll do that. Those are infants. In fact, the older a person gets who's still an infant, the more the rest of us notice. Right? Like, man, that guy needs to grow up. And this is for your own personal experience, you compare. What is the oldest infant you've ever seen? And I can say they can hit 60s and 70s once in a while. I'm not saying all. I'm just saying it's amazing how old you can get and still be very infant in the emotional department or the me department or the, you know, I want what I want. I'm gonna complain and stomp my feet if I don't get what I want. Still happens. Some people can carry on like, no. This is talking about growing up. And it also mentions, knocked back and forth by the waves, which if you've ever been out in the ocean, it can take you. You know, I used to play around in Santa Cruz a lot. You get caught in the current, you could be near the beach one moment and heading out to sea the next. Do you understand how that happens? All the water's coming in and slapping the shore. But at some point, the water coming in has to return. This return current, you can't always tell where it's at. It's there along the beach somewhere. The water's got to be going somewhere. Otherwise, the beach would just fill up and we'd all drowned, right? So the water is returning out to sea somehow, but you can't see that return current. But if you're floating along, you can find it. And again, one minute you're by the beach, and the next minute you're out. You're going out to sea. One time I had a guy on a surfboard help me get back. That's how far I'd gotten out. Santa Cruz. Once. I got better at it. Technically, if you watch for bubbles, you can see a bubble trail going back out. Or, you know, kelp and things, they start heading back out again. If you see that, that is that current. Anyway, another beach safety lesson from Fernley Free Methodist Church. You're going to grow up. You're not going to be knocked around and blown here and there by every wind of teaching. There's still many winds of teaching all the time, all sorts of new ones, all sorts of new fads and things and come and go. You're not going to fall for it. Why? And it says they're cunning and crafty people and they're deceitful scheming. Some people are trying to get rich and coming up with new ideas. Some people just like to think they know a lot and come up with new ideas. I don't know what all the reasons are, but that's not what it's supposed to be. What is it supposed to be? Verse 15, instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of him who is the head, that is Christ. We're growing up to be like him. We're growing up to be his body on earth. That is Christ. Verse 16, from whom the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. Well, I encourage you, don't paint every denomination with a big brush. But for fun, if you see a church, this is a church, something or another, look it up online. Go to that ready to harvest. See what they believe. You know, I know I do that sometimes. Oh, what is a church of the whatchamacallit? I've never even heard of that. You know, and if there's enough of them, you can look it up. If there's only one of them, might be. You're not going to know what's going on until you get in the door. And then it might be eye-opening. The whole body, fitly joined together, supported by every ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. Everybody does their part. Not just this denomination, not just the independent church. You know, I think when I was writing this down, I thought about the part in Corinthians where one guy says, well, I was baptized by Paul. Well, I was baptized by Peter. As if that meant something. I don't care whether you're an independent church, a denominational church, that's not going to be the big issue when you get there. Who is Jesus and what did you do with him? That will be the big question. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, I thank you. I thank you for the words. I thank you for the churches in town that work together to try to help the community with food and clothes and different things, even if they have different names on the building. I ask you to help us all grow, become mature, and not get led astray by winds and waves of doctrine and tossed by the sea. Thank you for this time, this hour. In Jesus' name, amen.